Hello, welcome to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm the RPG Chick. This is a Let's Play where you get to decide at the end of the episode what happens next. And, well, I didn't get any video. I didn't get any, actually, votes from the last episode until, like, a week later. So there was no episode last Monday, which I do apologize for, but I need at least 2 votes, guys, in order to have a new episode go up. 2 votes or next week, no episode. So just keep in mind, please vote. I really appreciate it, and I'd like you guys to be involved as much as possible. Now, the Chainmaker. Hope you can't see that banner across the top. It's really annoying. I'm already recording. Shadowplay, thank you. There is no use fighting with the heavy chains. Now things glitching out. You wait. A shadow appears in the doorway. It is the Chainmaker. A great hulk of his fin, like those you met in the village of Torapani. So yeah, we stole a bunch of his stuff and we got some blimberry juice and we got some chains. Oh, a small vial of glue, which we need for one of our spells, actually. But then we got stuck in a trap. So he whips away the net. Intruder, huh? The Chainmaker growls fiercely and snatches up a particularly heavy length of metal, holding it like it was thread. So he's probably very skilled at these chains. So both the votes I got last episode said I should talk my way out of this. So let's try to talk our way out of it. I'm not stealing from you, you reply calmly. I called out, but you didn't hear me. I heard nothing, the Chainmaker growls suspiciously. You must have been working. That's where you're wrong, the Chainmaker declares. I was scratching. He lumbers toward you, swinging his chain. Okay, so now we're down to fight him or cast a spell. Spells. Where's my spells? Find the piece of paper that I wrote my spells on. Because in real life, we would not be able to do this. Here it is. What do we have available? Did I see you? I might have seen this last time. We have available. Obviously, we got hot, which is fireball. Not very good in an enclosed space like this. We have R-A. We have Raz. That is... Blade does 2 times or more damage, which requires beeswax. I don't think we have beeswax. Do we? I think I pretty much know where we would get beeswax. Magical items. Yeah, no beeswax. I got blimberry juice. I have the giant net. Well, I think I got that from somewhere else. I might have. I'm not sure. So yeah, we can't do Raz. Found out pretty early on that it lets you cast spells that you don't have ingredients for. Fix. What does fix do? Does it fix something? Ooh. I need a staff of... Ooh, do I have that? Hold animate, inanimate on... That might be that staff. Fix would be awesome. Then I could just make away with all this stuff. I'm so bad. I have a walking cane. I don't have a staff of whatever. My apologies, guys. I think I might have looked at these at the end of last episode, but I don't remember. So, and we have M-U mud, which is a, like, is that like a web spell? A web spell is web, isn't it? Mud. Mud, 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 mud. Quicksand requires sand. I don't think we have sand. We need all this stuff. I think it would all be under magical items. I'm just checking this stuff anyway. Yeah, we don't have sand. Right? Yeah, I'm not seeing sand. Nothing even remotely like sand. Music's always so loud. So I think all that's left is... Fireball? Well, that's the is this the second? Yeah, these are the second. What the hell, let's try it. Fireball! Boom! Oh! You cast a spell and hurl an enormous fireball at the Chainmaker. He incinerates into a pile of ash, surrounded by a pool of molten metal. With the Chainmaker dead, you quickly look what he has left behind and find 4 more gold pieces. Nice. On the way out of the shop, a silver chain catches your attention. Yeah, I didn't want to kill him into a pile of ash and molten metal, but well, he didn't leave me much choice, did he? Otherwise, I wouldn't fighting and killing him, you know, in more mundane matter, but he'd still be dead. It's a pretty horrible way to die, isn't it? We're obviously going to look at the chain. There's no use for it anymore. The silver chain is clearly enchanted. The ends seem to snap and bite it one another like an amorous snakes. You may be able to use it in battle quite effectively. As you leave the shop, you call a thank you to the Chainmaker for the chain, wishing his soul well. Oh, it was still generally a good person, I guess. So we have this chain. Is it magical? I don't see it. Is it treasure? I mean weapons. Silver chain. Well, maybe we can use a silver chain instead of the sword. That's interesting. Yeah, can't be red. But we got this from Mulas. How are we gonna figure out what his stuff is, what his line is. Now that's back where it came from. Walk on, cut through the fields. I don't think we did that. So what if we cut through the fields? You continue along the road. The land rises gently, a thin, meager scrub broken by rocky outcrops like teeth through an infant's gum. Outcrops like tea. Okay. That sentence didn't make sense to me. Goats roam the slopes, paranoid, shifty creatures who flee at the sound of your footsteps. Suddenly, you could be back in the fields outside Krista Tanti. Your stomach rumbles with hunger. Let's eat. Let's look under the stones. We need to eat, too. You pause and turn over a few of the nearby stones, and sure enough, there is the torn note, just as you remembered. If you should find this, then Sansus has killed me after all. But of course, putting together the torn note and the paper fragment from the corpse's throat, you see they are a perfect fit, and they clearly form a spell line. I bid you portals open wide. The second noble Mulas must have tried to swallow his note before he was killed, or whatever it was that happened to him. Spell lines are listed in the keys. You put the note fragment into your pack and continue walking along the track, and begin to hear the sound of a large crowd up ahead. There's some kind of market or fair happening further on near the river. You pass a dirt track on the left that leads away across the fields. I wanted to eat, though. Keys, right? Mulas's line. I bid you portals open wide. We still need half of it. This is what I hate. Can we... I can't rest now. I can't... Well, it's akin to resting. I'm gonna see... Hopefully this is after we kill the Chainmaker. Although we can just do it again. Ugh. Okay. Three gold pieces. Blimberry juice. Gonna retrace my steps here. Cause that's the one thing about the game I don't like. Because I looked under a stone, I can't take my rations. I guess I could take them at any time, but... Okay, so now what if... See, I'd save the game now if I could. What if I stop to eat? You find a low stone to perch on and rest to eat a quantity of your cheese and bread. You feel much better for it. Cities are deceptively tiring. Distances are always greater than you expect. It is impossible to fall into the easy swing of a walk in the open country. Ah! You stand to continue your journey, but then you notice something sticking out from under the rock you're sitting on. A corner of something larger? Definitely a corner. You take hold and gently tug free a short handwritten note. It must be quite old, as the once fine paper has turned to green with mold. But shielded from the rain, the ink remains quite legible. The first line is intriguing. If you should find this, then Sansus has killed me after all. It's told in a slightly different way. But of course, putting together the torn note and the paper fragment from the corpse's throat, you see they're a perfect fit, and they clearly form a spell line. I bid you portals open wide. The second noble Mulas must have tried to swallow his note before he was killed, or whatever it was that happened to him. Alright. Just let me take a look again. Oh, keys. Will this be enough? I don't want to go through this. Let's cut through the fields. I'm afraid of getting pickpocketed again. You turn off the main track and onto the dirt road. It passes along the edge of the fields, rising and falling through the scrub and cut hay before petering out to become a mere goat path. You are no longer sure if this is a real path at all. There is a rocky rise up ahead. Let's go up the rise. You crest the rise, intending to get a view of the way ahead, then pause at a sound from behind you. It is the quiet shh of a dagger drawing from a sheath. Alright, our choices. We've got Yob. Yob is Summon Giant. I don't think we have the thing anymore. I think we already summoned a giant. We can't do so again. Let me see. We do have a giant's tooth. But could I summon it in time? That's the question. We got Summon Giant Law, which is Charm Animal, or Stupid Beings. I don't know if this is going to be a stupid being. I've got 6, which is Mirror Image. I always like that spell. I might cast that, actually. I've got J.A. Jaw. Jaw. Jaw is something I don't think I've ever casted before. Jaw. Where's Jaw? Jaw, baby Jaw. Jawing with it. I don't see it. I don't see a Jaw. Did I miss writing that down? I hear people laughing in the background. Nobody laughing at me. Can't find the goddamn Jaw. Look on the other side again. Huh. Let me write it, because... Oh, that's an L. Sorry, guys. I already looked at that. Why did I think that was a J? It looks like a J there. That's an L. Wait. That's a J. Oh, what the hell? I must have clicked next to it. Jig, which is uncontrollable dancing. That's awesome. I've never cast that before. I need a bamboo flute for that. I don't know if I have a bamboo flute. I should write down all the ingredients, like, stuff that I have. Let's see if we have a bamboo flute. We got two halves of a note. Ah. I bid you portals open wide. I don't have... Wish I had his whole spell line and we could actually... Can I guess the rest? Alright guys, we're going to do it. We're gonna cast something. I can't cast the uncontrollable dancing. So Jig is a no-go. What's the other thing? Yob? Yob is... I think that's a no-go as well. Oh, Summon Giant. We can actually do that. I don't think it uses up the tooth either. So... I could be wrong. Yeah, let's Summon Giant. Which one is it? Yob, right? You toss down a tooth and cast your spell. A tooth ignites, turning into a column of smoke, from which steps a giant. You can hear whoever it is behind you gasp with horror, and then you hear their footsteps running off through the fields. The giant chases them, grunting with pleasure at the exercise. The two disappear out of sight. I hope I still have my giant tooth. No, damn it, I don't. Still, it was fun. Maybe I'll find some more at some point. Follow the path. The path winds through fields, passing an orchard on one side. The trees are dying and bare of apples. On the other side, across muddy fields, you see the colors and flags of a festival. Then the view is surrounded by tall fences on either side. Look at the fences. You pause to look at the fences. The fields they contain seem ordinary enough, but for some reason, the fences themselves are 2 or 3 times your height. There are no ladders to climb over that you can see, and no gates. A spell might be helpful here. Look through the fence. Peering through the fence, you see a square field of very long grass, which seems to be ungrazed, and which no one has cropped in a long time. Anything might be hidden in there. Yes. And anything might be lurking in there. What, I'm gonna cast a spell of what? Make myself a giant form? I'm guessing fireball to... Oh, how? Psychic info. That's pretty much... I think that's concerned with escape. TEL, which is telepathy. Read mind. Whose? There's no one around to read the mind of. At least, not that I know of. I got B.I. Big, which is, yeah, giant form. I think I'll summon giant form, or I'll cast giant form. We've also got, whoop, that was weird. We've got Zap, which is a lightning bolt, right? Yep, lightning bolts. S-U-S, which is detect trap. S-A-P, sap. Sap. Do I have that? I gotta have it. Sap. I am not seeing. Sap. Foe loses morale. Yeah, we'll make the fence lose morale. Alright, let's cast big. Notorious B.I.G. Bump. You cast a spell growing to 3 times your normal size, easily tall enough to see over the fences, but there's nothing in the fields they contain, except for long grass, which doesn't seem so long anymore. I'll step over it. You step over the fence into the field of long grass. Probably gonna get bit by a snake or something. The giant spell fades, leaving you standing in a field of grass that comes up almost to your neck, surrounded on all sides by a tall fence. The field appears to be empty, however. In real life, why would I be doing this? Search the grass, I'd probably get my hand in a bear trap or something. You crouch low, and feel around the grass to see if there's anything hidden there. Suddenly, something grabs your wrist, holding you down low. Struggle free. You try to tug your arm free, but in thrashing around, you succeed only in tangling your other limbs up in whatever it is that has hold of you. You are now fully held and being pulled down towards the earth. Pray for aid. You begin a quick and fervent prayer to the ape, and after a moment, you feel the grip on your arms and legs loosening. You waste no time and hurry away up the fence like a spider, dropping back down gratefully onto the path. I wonder what the hell it was, dragging me into the earth. Looking back, the field looks like nothing but a field of grass. If it weren't for the red marks on your wrist, you would believe you had imagined the whole affair. Nah, it was real. Okay, I'm gonna head for the exit, I think, because maybe this is good enough. Maybe Korga can help me. You emerge onto a wide road that leads up a gentle slope toward the cliff edge. Weren't we able to ask Korga, like, one spell line or something like that? Or where it was? Look at the cliff. You turn to look up at the cliff, which rises suddenly out of the middle of the fields. Along its ridge is a line of finer buildings, though most have fallen into wrack and ruin. Down the road. Looking back downhill, you see a few distant buildings and beyond the point where the three roads into Kharé diverged. Time to move on. I agree. What does this say? Turn left, turn right. Well, I want to cross this, and I think the only way to cross the friggin' river is here. So we need to make our way back up. Boy, it doesn't take forever. There's a little house here. You continue tramping through the fields until, after about half an hour, you emerge onto a wider road heading uphill toward the center of Kharé. To the right of the main road, a track lined with colored flags leads along the line of the cliff leading towards the fair you heard earlier. Yes, we went through there as well. A short distance from the road is a small hut built from mud bricks. Smoke rises from its chimney, and a thick, rich smell wafts from its door. If it is a shop, it can't get much trade stuck out here in the middle of the fields. Take the main road, half of the flags. We have to investigate. Enter the small hut. Not gonna knock, just gonna go right in. Oh, we are gonna knock then. Those are the exact things I said, almost. Barge right in. The door to the small hut is a little ajar. A pleasant smell drifts out, but you hear nothing from inside. Knock, knock, knock. You knock firmly on the door. A voice calls back, "Enter, friend, but be careful as you open the door." Slip through the doorway. You slip through the doorway as carefully as you can. Looking up, you notice a jar of some kind of liquid balanced precariously atop the door. Oh, why wouldn't they specifically tell me there's something... The shop is a kitchen. There's a fire in the grate with a pot above it, which bubbles and smokes. On the walls hang herbs, vegetables, meats, and cooking equipment. But no matter how hard you look, you cannot seem to see the speaker. Look near the hearth. Am I going to get pushed in? What is this stuff? What is that? Some kind of octopus? Well, those are more than 8 legs. 8 tentacles. That's the speaker, isn't it? He's holding this. And that. Let's look under the table. I see him. I'm pretty sure I see him. Looking around for anybody else. Oh, there's rats or mice here. Or could even be lizards, possibly. You look under the table, which is full of clutter, wondering if there's someone hiding there. But all you see is junk and a small box containing a scroll and a mirror. "You done poking around my kitchen, Captain?" says the voice. I'm going to play dumb. "Where are you?" "Right here, Captain." Looking again, you suddenly notice the strange-looking creature standing beside the pot as he starts to wave a ladle. Yep. He has a human torso, but his head is nothing but a green-colored jelly. He is hard to spot because of the vegetables standing on the wall behind him, but you can tell he is the chef, as the long, sinuous tentacles coming from his head are scooping with ladles, stirring with spoons, waving salt shakers, and brandishing a cleaver. "So, what do you want?" asked the creature. "Yeah, like I'm just going to suddenly attack it." He's looking right at me. I'm not going to take the stuff. Talk. "Greetings, creature," you begin. "Look," the creature complains. His tentacles go back to stirring, chopping, and mixing. "I don't have all day. What do you want?" This and this. "I'm trying to find the city nobles." Well, I found them, right? "They aren't hiding in here," the creature says. "Last I heard, they're hiding in their council chamber with their guard, afraid of winter or something." "I'd like to buy some food. Is it safe?" "All right," the creature replies, giving his cauldron a quick stir, but not taking his eyes off you. "It's 5 gold pieces, and it's bristle beast kidneys. Hope that's all right with you." That's too much," you tell him. He shrugs, in a waft of tentacles. You leave the hut. Oh. All right. Now, yeah, I should have left that up for interpretation for you guys to vote on. I want to head across, back across, so I can go eventually all the way through here. So I'm going to head this way, which hopefully will let me go up that way. You follow the wide path between the flags. After a few minutes, you notice something in the distance, a dark mass with bright colors shining through. It is not until you hear the sound when you realize what it is, a huge crowd of people gathered around a set of tents. It is a fair. I don't want to hang out here. People and creatures across the path and several tents have been erected, their poles joined together by more flags. I'm keeping an eye on my gold. You ease your way into the edge of the gathered crowd. It all looks good-spirited and fun, and with so many people here, perhaps you will pick up useful information about the spell lines and the city nobles. Listen, sure, why not? You mill through the crowd, keeping your ears open for anything interesting, but most people in the center of the field are arguing where to go next, lamenting how many gold pieces they have spent. You might do better to have a closer look at something. I want to leave, though. I don't want to... Ah! I don't want to go that way. We've been here before. The beginning of this chapter. Dancers. Yes, let's leave. You push your way through the crowd, following the road uphill. The party is getting wilder, and you would do well to be away from here before things get out of hand. At the far edge of the fair, the litter has left a tide mark on the grass. There is one last small tent here, probably a ticket booth, that has simply been ignored by the crowds of Kharé. Look back. Seen that? Look ahead. Small tent. Yeah, remember that. I'm pretty sure I played that as well as we end up losing money with that. You are back by the bathhouse on the edge of the fair. Let's head uphill. The road twists and turns up the rise until you emerge onto a wider road on the edge of dense slum. From inside down a street to the left, you can hear the very faint sound of singing. A smell of rotting fish begins to fill the air. You must be close to the docks. Now, what's interesting is that we didn't come here of our own volition last time. We were, like, knocked out and brought here, I think? Yeah, we were thrown in this boat with a bunch of werewolves. So let's head for the docks. We haven't seen that under our own power. Or I might have been unconscious that time. The smell of rotting fish and murky water fills your nostrils. You know this area well enough. You have reached the docks once more. The beating heart of Kharé. There are two or three ships moored for the night, and the space between them and the road is filled with a huge number of stalls and little shops selling everything from fishing tackle to sailing blocks to barrels of woodlouse rum. This must be a thriving marketplace during the day. With night approaching, it is a maze of booths and cloth. A single bridge crosses the river here, operated with ropes to let the tall ships through. Right now, the bridge is up to allow ships to sail through undisturbed. There are two inns visible from here, the Wayfarer's Rest and the Meat and Cleaver. There is nothing obviously different about either of them. Also somewhere nearby is the Shrine of Slangg. Really? Sleep in the market. Check out the shrine. Remembering that the shrine is near the docks, you search the side streets until you see a promising-looking low building. You step into the doorway of the shrine, at the same time as a woman and her child are leaving. "He really is a holy man, mother," the little one is saying. Lazen's lame brother answered his question and he ran off the stage. The mother nods and the pair leave. Interesting. Huh. The shrine is an old stone building, garishly decorated with hanging cloths and thick candles that fill the air with the smell of grease and tar. At the far end, on a low platform, stands a hooded figure in a white robe who is talking to the assembled crowd. The image looks remarkably familiar, as though you had seen almost this exact same scene before, but you cannot place it. What are these? Are these tiles on the ground? Or are they sitting on cards? Is that the sun? He looks very old. Does anyone else wish to take the test of Slangg, the god of malice? Doesn't sound like a good god to be following. A murmur grows around the crowd. People are nervous, but excited. Examine the crowd. The crowd is a mixture of young and old, women and men. Some cheer and joke and murmur, while others have their legs and arms folded in a devout pose and pray through silent lips. How many are spectators and how many are followers of Slangg you cannot tell. Anyone who can answer the question will be granted their wish. The priest continues. Yes, someone. You nudge someone next to you. What is this challenge? You ask. is a test of Slangg, the woman replies in a whisper. He grants you a wish if you answer him correctly, but you have to worship him or else the question he asks is impossible. She shudders and grins. They don't call him the god of malice for nothing. As he waits for an answer, the priest plucks a knife from his belt and casually stabs it into his own hand. This doesn't sound... You gotta worship him. You have to answer him correctly, but if you don't worship him, the question he asks is impossible. Meaning this should say Slangg, I'm guessing? I'm gonna wait and watch. Suddenly a man leaps to his feet. I'll do it, he declares. The rest of the group cheers, and the man, a geriatric, is helped up onto the platform. Are you a follower of Slangg? The man spits. Very well. In one corner of the room, a gong is sounded and the crowd falls silent. Gonna watch some more. Which do you choose? The priest demands of the man. Will you take the impossible challenge or pay the price of the easy challenge? The man looks uncertain and turns to the audience. People begin to shout suggestions. I'm thinking the easy challenge is harder, more debilitating. I mean, maybe they chop off his arm and... I don't know. I don't know what pertains to, like, what's the ramifications of either of these choices are, so I'm going to wait to see what happens. You sit back, curious, to see what happens. The crowd is split. Some want the drama of the impossible, others wanting to see the man be granted his blessing. After a few minutes, the priest quietens the room and turns back to the man. So, what do you choose? I'll take the impossible challenge, the man grins. Very well, very well, the priest declares. There is no price for the impossible challenge. Are you ready? The man nods excitedly. The crowd hushes. Wait and listen. Then tell me, the priest says, what is the answer to the question that is never asked? The man falls silent for a moment, chewing his lower lip and musing over his answer. Finally, he says, silence. Is he correct? The priest smiles sadly and shakes his head. A clever answer, but not correct. The crowd sighs in disappointment. The woman next to you remarks, people always try the impossible challenge. You'd think they get the hint. The man leaves the platform and the priest turns back to the crowd. Who will be next? Take the challenge. You raise your hand and step forward. I will take the challenge. A stranger, calls the priest with glee. Welcome her, please. I'm choosing impossible. The crowd whispers and murmurs as you make your way up to the platform. So strange that they're using singular verbs with crowd. Yeah. Welcome, stranger, the priest declares, helping you up. Are you ready to take the challenge, knowing full well that very few succeed? I am. The crowd cheers a response. Then know this. Slangg is not a punishing god, but he is malicious. He does not wish for you to fail, but should you fail, he wishes you to know that it was all your own fault. Okay, let him continue. The priest continues, our practice is that you may choose which question to answer, but know this, one is impossible, and the other is easy. And to answer the easy question, you must give up something you hold most dear. The crowd is watching in expectant silence. It is time for you to choose. I am choosing the impossible question. Well, it's one of three. Or maybe I don't know is a valid answer. The crowd waits expectantly. Then the priest closes his eyes and intones, what is the answer to the question that has never been asked? Your heart leaps. Your vision is coming to pass. Is it? My vision is coming to pass? I don't even remember. Maybe if I play this more than once a week, I'd remember. Hold up. Do we have a clue on this or something? Hold on. Because it'd be stupid. Yeah, might be able to help you find the spell lines to the gate. Well, we know where that is. Can't panny. Halls of Lana. The answer to the question? In a vision, you saw the answer to the question has never been asked, Sorcery, which makes no sense. But I will answer it thusly. Sorcery. There's a moment's pause as the priest screws up his eyes. Screws up his eyes. What's the result? The priest nods once, slowly. That is correct, he murmurs. The question has never been answered in the 3,000 years since this site was first made holy to Slangg. The answer has been passed on from one priest to the next. I never thought I would be the one to hear it spoken, because I do not understand it, and I do not know the question. He turns to you and bows his head once. You are truly blessed. Please, what is your wish? It's not here. I know the order of the spell lines. I wish to be rich beyond my imagination. Kharé. The order of the spell lines, I know that already. I want the rest of Mulas' spell line, dammit. Yeah. So I'm gonna make this the thing. So for the purposes of the game, I'm eliminating this. Can Kharé be saved? Because I believe it can. Pretty much a yes or no question. So guys, your answers, valid answers are, I wish to be rich beyond my imagination, who is Vic, or I wish to be stronger than anyone ever. Let me know what you think, guys. Please put your votes. Again, if votes are equal, if it's a tie, I'm going to, you know, roll the die. Probably a four-sided die, so it's still, you have a chance to, you know, have your vote be counted. And successful, that is. So, again, can Kharé be saved is out. Do not choose that. It'll be forfeit. Tell me the order of the spell lines is out. I already know that. That'll be forfeit. I wish to be rich beyond my imagination. Who is Vic? Oh, I wish to be stronger than anyone ever. We do get this. I mean, could be a lot of freaking gold pieces. Could find out more about Vic, which could help us. Other than he wants to be first noble and he's a werewolf. We might not learn more than that. I don't know. Oh, I wish to be stronger than anyone else. Yeah, stamina. Increase. So let me know what you think, guys. Thanks so much for watching, and see you in the next episode. See you next week, guys. Endure and enduring. Grow strong.